Hello. I am your radio host, Swoon, here with a game. A game that is very special to me. This isn't just Lovecraft inspired, this is the embodiment of Lovecraft. The art is so cute. I've played through 2 hours already, and I reached a point where I was like, I need to record this, and I need to do voices for it, because I just love it so much. So without further ado, let's begin a new game.
Bonjour, wee children. My name is Marie Peanut Butter, head of occult science at the Miskatonic University. Ours is the most prestigious institution of dark magic, the occult, and all the strange ghoulies that live in your peripheral vision. I'm here today to tell you a story about a little girl that ruined everything. But ruining everything gives you the opportunities to make everything better, oui oui. What's that, you ask? Why I have a giant hand sticking out of my head? Well, that is because I am French. It is a thing we have. Not so funny business, oui? You'll learn about the strange things people are afflicted with throughout the story. After this, you'll think my head hand is cute and adorable, as you should. But first, let me describe to you the state of the world prior to the witch girl that ruined everything. Do not fret, you probably know this already, oui? So, you are aware of the giant aliens that we call gods and the cultists that worship them, no? Then let me tell you. Some worship Cthulhu, the giant man octopus dragon thing. His cults teach eternal patience, waiting for Cthulhu to come back to them so he can destroy the world. Rude. Some worship Yogg-Sothoth, the outer-dimensional god of knowledge. These smarty brains tried to build portals to let him come here, but that would destroy the world too, not so smarty. Most humans, like our witch girl, worship Shub-Niggurath, known as the All-Mother. Even cultists for other gods will pray to Shub-Niggurath at the end of their spells and rituals. That is because Shub-Niggurath is the goddess of humanity. Her cultists preach love and compassion among everyone. Very lovely, oui? But, like our witch girl, some can be blinded by their desire for harmony. There are some that would take advantage of the naive notions that all humans are loving and good, not so lovely. Okay, so you know of gods now, we? So let's talk a small bit about the humans of the world. Some countries have been more affected than others by the strange happenings of the universe. For example, in Canada, yetis. Thousands of them. But the Canadians are well prepared. Yeti invasions are considered a national pastime. Bring the family, we'll shoot some yetis. This is what us French call an English person. Note the sharp teeth, purple bluish, and big ugly face. A couple decades ago, it was discovered that a huge percentage of the English nobility were actually cannibals, breeding humans in underground caves like livestock. Everyone in England went crazy when it was found out, so now they're all cannibals too. Apparently, the Scottish just found it hilarious. This one is also my boyfriend, so no touching his ugly face, we? These little fellows are called Australians. I love it. Oh, I love it so much. They're so cute. When the Shoggoths left Antarctica, they came across a big island filled with lovely, delicious humans, but these humans didn't want to be devoured, and even when half dissolved in the Shoggoth bellies, the humans would punch and kick and smash bottles inside them, making the Shoggoths very uncomfortable. So instead of trying to eat them, the Shoggoths formed this cute little symbiotic relationship with the Australians, granting them immortality in exchange for less punching. So the little Shanes and Sheilas can happily booze and barbecue away for all eternity. And this is called an American, note the silly haircut and gigantic bum. Specifically, this is the American that our story revolves around. The little witch girl that ruined everything. How can you tell she's a witch? Why, there are many clues. Example, the pasty skin, a symptom of spending her days asleep and her nights dancing naked in the rain with her coven to conjure strange hexes. Also, the little black choker thing. It's the closest thing to a uniform they get. Also, she doesn't wash. Are you gonna make me look like a dumbass in this story? Because it was only like 20% my fault. Our story begins with our smelly dumbass being briefed on the university's secret protocols after just being hired as a security guard for the occult science building. But on her first assignment, she discovers that all is not as it seems at the prestigious school. Thanks, nutsack.
Now, Miss Lestrange, you understand that as security agent, your off-site assignments are to be kept in the strictest confidence, even from other members of faculty, and especially the students.
Uh-huh.
You also understand that as a security agent, you'll be in very real danger, both from physical harm and mental corruption. You understand that your body is subject to mutation at any point during your employment and residence in Arkham.
Rad.
And finally, you understand that as a university of occult science, you are obliged to assist us with research regarding your supposed magic eyes, and failure to comply will result in your immediate dismissal.
Sure.
Well then, Miss Lestrange, welcome to the Miskatonic University.
Awesome. Ah, you must be the new security guard, Charlotte, right? Yep, that's me. Great, I'm Johnny, head of internal security. I'll be giving you a tour of the building. You'll be patrolling, then I'll show you to your quarters. Ready to go? Sure. Well, you'll be working here in the occult science building. You're a witch, right? Have you dabbled in any occult science? Well, I'm pretty good at the occult stuff, though mostly I use it for errands and favors for folks. Plus a few hexes, curses, blights, just to keep that witchy appearance. Blood into jam, bones into sponge cake, cat into mush, phallus into tiny screaming vestigial face. Normal stuff. Well, we do things a little differently here. This way. Awesome. This is the Aetherium, where our students can perform experiments on the Necronomicon. The creature acts as a shield to the outside world, keeping any experiments sterile and quarantining any unexpected summonings. Hi!
Hello!
We didn't know it could do that. Did you try talking to him? You are gonna provide some much needed common sense around here, Charlotte. This building also houses the Corporeum, a surgical theater where our students can perform vivisections and autopsies on otherworldly creatures. Ah, speaking of which, this is Eddie, one of our monster hunters. Thanks to him, our Corporeum professors have been able to gather more information on living horrors than any other time in university history. The trick is to figure out where its face is. No, that's Australian. The trick is to figure out where its face is and then commence repeated punching. Who's the new girl? This is Charlotte Lestrange, a witch from the Chess and Cook Coven. She'll be working security for this building. Hi. Looking after us rascals, eh? Well, just give me a clip around the back of the head if you see me slacking off and I'll get back to work. Eh, big stuff? I have been known to whip some ass with my big muscles. There you go. Come round Chop Shop. You want to see what me and the lads wrangled up the other day? You witches like nightmares, right? Sure. Well, the fun ones anyway. Like when your teeth fall out and you smooth them off with sandpaper to make a lovely necklace.
Or when you're running down a corridor in slow motion with a bunch of hands coming out of the carpet and grabbing your ankles, and you finally stop and ask them what they want, and it turns out your shoelaces were untied and they were just super concerned for your safety. Or when you're at school and you stand up in class, but you forgot your pants and you're embarrassed, but everyone compliments your butt. Well, you're a bloody weird one, Charlotte, so you'll fit right in here. Don't let my sister catch wind of you. She won't leave you alone, you telling stories like that. Ah, and here's our curator of the corporeum, Miss Marie Peanut Butter. She used to be a void shaman from Paris before coming to work with us. As fun and satisfying as the void is, my true passion lies in discovering how things work, we? I don't like that she says we all the time. Just gotta remind everybody that she's French. At least, when they are dead. Groovy, what's a void shaman? You know those dark thoughts you have sometimes, for seemingly no reason? The ones that tell you to jump at the edge of a cliff, or rob a bank when cashing a paycheck, or dropkick a grandma through a stained glass church window at a funeral? Oh yeah, I get those all the time. Well, those are not your thoughts. A few hundred years... God, I keep going Australian. A few hundred years ago, the French aristocrats' way of life was so decadent and whim-filled, their unbridled sauciness only went and summoned a bloody hedonism god. Damn thing lives under the Paris catacombs, communicates telepathically with people all over the world, urging them to give in to their darkest whims. The French get it the worst, of course. So these here shamans take it upon themselves to do the dark deeds, so the rest of France doesn't have to. Must be a right giggle. My last act as a shaman before coming here, I took off my clothes, covered myself in lemon cake and green food coloring, and terrorized the local village as a delicious swamp monster. I quite enjoyed that one. Shall we press on with the tour? Sure. Bye, you guys. So, not to be rude, but judging from the bandaged up arms and the sick eye scar and the terror lines in your hair, I'm getting the impression that security work here is, you know, a little dangerous. Oh, no. Not for you, at least. The occult science building is probably the safest on campus. Because if something went wrong in this building, we'd all be too dead to notice. Don't listen to her. She's just a little jealous that the new girl gets the cushy gig while she's stuck in the math department. What happens in the math department? What doesn't happen in the math department? There is nothing so cold, so unforgiving, so dark as the mathematicians. The universe is not but an equation. They shriek, bind their burnt hair in sludge-tainted cardigans. One that can be solved. But how do you solve the equation of a dozen screaming children being ingested by a black swirling chasm of teeth and clawing hands opened at the far end of the classroom by one of their damnable equations? Damn you, young Henry. Carry that damned two. So let's carry on with the tour. Next up is the library. Awesome! Each building hosts a small library dedicated to researching and documenting the subjects that the building's students are studying. Here in the Cult Silence building, we keep an original copy of the Necronomicon, as well as translated copies for our foreign exchange students. That's a lot of knowledge. Oh, and here's our librarian. Charlotte, meet Miss Emily Saccharine. Ooh, blue. Hi, I love your mask. I didn't know you guys had a Shoggoth here. And a tame one, too. Oh, Emily isn't a Shoggoth. She just had a small accident with a Necronomicon a while ago, ended up like this. But our occult scientists learned an awful lot about what happens with these tomes of black knowledge when you spill your soy, no whip, ice, caramel, macchiato, two shots hazelnut on them. Huh. Sure looks like a Shoggoth. Purple, gooey, moderately adorable, with a hint of terrifying. Well, that's the Necronomicon for you. It's funny. Spilling a non-fat frappuccino with extra whipped cream and chocolate sauce just turns you into a puddle of loose bones and blood. Still, hasn't stopped Emily from performing her duties, eh, Emily? Shall we press on? Okay. Nice to meet you, Emily.
Charlotte, this is Lizzie of Dunwich, our Yogg-Sothoth consultant. She taught us quite a lot about the other dimensions during her time here. Lizzie, Charlotte's the new security witch.
Are you the sort of witch that does the naked in the rain, or the sort of witch that does the lucky charms and the big hats?
The rain kind.
You and me are gonna get along. Yes.
So, like, how come I can't... What are you?
I'm a Lizzie. What are you?
No, I mean, like, why do you look like a shadow? Or, like, part of my eyeball has stopped working?
It's 'cause humans can't see, 'cause they're all afraidy of me and my sister's appearances. Everything else can see me, so why doggies all tuck tails when I go near them.
Lizzie is an example of a mental phenomenon found only in humans known as cerebral voiding. It's a trick by the brain to preserve the sanity of its carrier. When a person comes across sights too horrible to comprehend, their brain refuses to render it, instead showing a black silhouette in place of the sight itself. Essentially, instead of Lizzie's insanity-inducing true form, your brain is protecting you by showing you a shadow instead. But I saw that interviewer, no problem, the guy whose face was just teeth and gums, and the girl with the hands sticking out of her head, and Emily the librarian. Yep, Lizzie and her Dunwichian sisters are in a league of their own when it comes to horrific appearances. We sent a lot of the students to the asylum trying to figure her out. That is awesome.
Yes.
Lizzie is so cute.
Here's our head of catering, Miss Roth. She can cook anything with three or more legs.
Yum. Hi.
Oh, look at you, witches, all skin and bones. Just let one of my little gremlins know what fills your tum and I'll whip it right up. Oh my gosh, here we go.
My favorite character. What's the humanitarian dish for today?
Dave, from accounting, my dearest.
Oh, pork sandwiches. Lummy, lummy, yum.
We employ a small staff of cannibals from England. Eddie in the corporeum and Annie being two of them. They only eat flesh, accidental deaths, with the family's consent, usually.
Oh, I get it. Humanitarian. It's funny.
Well, once you're done with John's little tour, let me know and I'll make you breakfast.
You're making her into breakfast? Let me have the arse portion. We'll make steak and kidney pie, big ol' witch rump.
You ain't eating no rump steak, Annie. Your little hordes got poor old Dave.
Aw, oh, come on. At least let me have your ugly feet, eh? Nice and lean, covered in flavor, and entirely useless. Look at them all the way down there. When I'm done with them. Great. Let me get a little appetizer, eh? A little lick in between the toesies. Pre-brunch snacklet, how about it?
Don't encourage her, dear. She'll be crawling all over me till your feet fall off.
My bad.
Speaking of cannibals.
Good morning, Miskatonic. It's your favorite morning announcement.
Oh, shit, she's fucking English.
Good morning, Miskatonic. It's your favorite morning announcer, Mindy in the Morning, bringing you all the Miskatonic morning announcements as and when I see fit. It's currently 2:30 in the afternoon, so let's get started. Those of you students that have volunteered for the submerged necromantic mutation testing, that has unfortunately been called off by Professor Baxter on the grounds that the school's swimming pool is now alive. Lunch today will be turgid and depressing. And would the owner of a white child please report to the reception office? It's currently being towed.
What was that?
That's Mindy, the morning announcer.
Does she do that a lot?
Perpetually. You seem pretty comfortable around this stuff, Charlotte.
Oh, I grew up in Maine. Not as many mutated folk, but they make up for it with all the goofy new supernatural happenings.
Hey, Johnny, Thirst has been looking for you.
Thanks, Chasm. Come on, Charlotte. I gotta make a quick stop off.
What happened to her?
Oh, that's Chasm. One of our portal dive team. They usually work out of Dunwich, coming back to write reports on their expeditions. When they come back, of course. So, let me make a quick stop and I'll show you to your room.
Ah, Johnny, so this is the strange girl. The crumbler. The ruiner.
Wow, look at this guy. I like how your coat melts into the floor.
Yep, this is her, Charlotte. This is Dr. Thirst Valentine, head of the occult science and the discoverer of residual evil. His work taught the university about the lingering nature of documenting malicious entities. Essentially, he figured out why seemingly innocuous writings can summon horrific creatures or cast terrible curses.
It is why the books bleed.
That's cool. I had a book that kept growing teeth and screaming and whatnot. It was my diary, though.
Excellent. I shall inform my colleagues of your arrival. We will merrily indulge in the popped corn. Ta-ta.
I like him.
You know, you've come highly recommended, Charlotte.
Oh yeah? By who?
Charlotte!
I can't believe they finally hired my tiny baby monster. Roman, what are you doing here? I got me some gainful employment teaching kids about old school dark magic. None of this occult science in my class. What have they got you teaching?
Oh, you know, I'm in security, keeping folks safe, wandering the halls, swinging a comically large keychain, bopping folks on the head with a flashlight, top secret missions, stuff like that.
Pretty on point hiring selection, if you ask me.
Yeah, safety. That's definitely a key word when I think of Charlotte Lestrange and her magic eyeballs.
Hey, those cats turned inside out on their own. I sneezed.
Hush your gums. Well, speaking of cosmic abominations, I gotta go teach a bunch of 18-year-olds how to turn blood into peanut butter by dancing in the rain. You're gonna love it here, Charlotte. The Miskatonics... The Miskatonics just one big like-minded community, all working towards making the world a better place, just like our coven. Come find me when you've got some time off.
There is nothing cosmic about them, Roman. They were just cats with their bones on the outside. They got better.
So, you two are in some kind of cult?
Sort of. We're witch cultists of Shub-Niggurath. Essentially, we believe that since the universe is filled with crazy awful bullshit, that humans should be nice and loving to each other. Some of us, like the Cult of the Black Sun, have these awesome bake sales for their neighborhoods, where others, like the Cult of Loveliness, hunt and slaughter encroaching monsters to protect their hometowns. We're sort of like goth Girl Scouts.
What about you witches?
We take all of our clothes off and dance in the rain. Typical witchy stuff. But we use black magic to do nice things for the townsfolk. Body snatching breech birth babies to make them crawl out of their mom, summoning fixer pixies when a guy's leg falls off, using transmutation circles as portals for when the trash collectors want a week off. Stuff like that.
Wait a minute. The Cult of the Black Sun does do bake sales? And the Cult of Loveliness are monster hunters. What, does the Cult of Kill, Murder, Death plant gardens or something?
Oh, you mean the Cult of Fetid Retribution? No, no. Those guys deliver meals to old ladies.
And what was that about magic eyes?
Oh, don't worry about that. I just do this. And sometimes weird stuff happens in people's minds. Usually they forget something or get an eye twitch. Long as I don't use it on little animals, it's pretty harmless.
Okay, so let's keep going. This is your room. A little tight, but the lunch lady brings us security guys breakfast every day. I'll let you get settled, then you can explore your patrol route until Bob gives you your first assignment.
It's perfect. Thanks, Johnny. Okay, I better go familiarize myself with my patrol route. Hello again. It's time for a quick tutorial, we? You're about to enter what's called patrol mode, wherein you're allowed to freely investigate the occult science building. Use your mouse to click characters to initiate conversations or doorways to move to other places in the building. Charlotte's patrol will always start here. Outside her room. Outside her room. And if you want to save the game, hit the little cog in the bottom right of the screen. Give it a try. And don't forget to visit me at the Corporeum, oui? Alright, we're at the staff dormitories. Please report all breakages, spillages, corpses, interdimensional tears, and unattended viscera to a member of janitorial staff. They are appropriately trained in sanitation, body disposal, quantum physics, and mild voodoo. I should look around, meet some folks, get the lay of the land and all that. I'm gonna be working here for a while. Hello, Spooky. How's your feet? Why the fascination with my feet, Annie? Surely the juiciest stuff for cannibals is, like, the brain or whatever. Oh, no. Can't eat brains, my lovey. Eating brains gives you the shiggles. Shiggles? What's the shiggles? Shits and giggles. An English disease makes you shiver and laugh uncontrollably while you lose control of your body. Then you die. I had a friend who had it back home, significantly less hilarious than it sounds. Ah, that sucks, man. Yep, and now I'm all inconsolable, and the only way to cheer me up is to give me a bite of your giant bum. Damn it, Annie, you almost had me feeling like you weren't a complete ass. I won't need the complete ass, just half a cheek at most. Okay, that was pretty clever. I'm here all week. I love Annie so much. Oh my god.
Did you know? Before it was completely abandoned, Innsmouth desperately tried to become a tourism town. Tried to focus on aquatic circuses, gift shops, and freak shows featuring leftover deep ones. I happened to be named most attractive deep one hybrid every weekly beauty contest.
Huh, you don't look like a deep one.
That's probably why I kept winning.
So I'm subbing a class for one of the astronomy guys, right? And substituting means it's time to watch a documentary in the lecture hall. And everyone's watching this thing, and it's like the closest star to our solar system is about 4.5 light years away, and you thought you felt lonely. And I'm like, why would you assume that? Why assume that literally every person who watches this thing? I grew up in a coven surrounded by spell-slinging psycho bitches, and now I work at a university. I salivate at the concept of loneliness. I wonder if they say that in a nature documentaries too, trying to make weird animals relatable. Oh wait, I think that was Charlotte. I wonder if they say that about weird animal documentaries and stuff. Yeah, and you thought you what? Yeah, and you thought you sprayed pungent urine at attacking predators.
And you thought you had projectile tongue that was sticky at the end so you could catch cute bugs.
And you thought you had a four-headed penis.
What the F has a four-headed penis?
Echidnas. Maybe girl echidnas are into the whole eldritch horror kink. Guy echidnas gotta keep their game up and turn their pain into horrific nightmares.
I have no argument for this. Treat the fellers. Arkham anti-mutation lotion. Keep... something.
You're the new security girl, right? I'm Nico Day. Archivist of the cult science building, feel free to tell me your deepest and darkest.
Okay. I left school when I was 9 to become a witch and quietly hope that school doesn't teach people anything important past that.
Interesting. And they do, by the way, quite a bit.
Oh. Well, shit.
Don't listen to him. If you can count and spell, everything else is optional. Roger Cavendish, Chief Medical Officer. Now, what does that tell you? You can do more than count and spell, right, Doctor? Well, a few things. Bringing people back from the brink of a terrible baphometic death, creating vaccines for supernatural diseases. Have you ever seen a prosthetic tentacle? Don't get him started on his damn prosthetic tentacle. Any more little nuggets of secrecy, Charlotte? Okay, here's a fine one. People think that I cock my hips all the time because of the Shub Niggeroth witch coven thing, when really it's because I'm secretly proud of my butt. It's a good butt. The rest of me sucks, but it's a damn good butt. On behalf of all cannibals, thank you for sharing it with the world. You're welcome. I love Annie so much. God damn it. Annika Silverstein, what is your voice?
It's the new security. Annika Silverstein, Alien Theology.
Caleb? Oh shit, he's fucking English too. Oh god.
I can only do so many English voices. And it's better when they're female.
Oh, Jesus. Caleb Wake, the Call Worms, fucking god, I hate this guy. I'm sorry, just off the bat, I just hate this guy. I've had like 5 interactions with him through all the time that I've already played so far, and I just don't like him. And it's not because of his puns. I promise. What is Caleb Boykinshaw, pun enthusiast?
Charlotte Lestrange, badass witch cop. So, what happened to the last security guy? Are they on sick retirement adventures?
Last I heard, he landed in Aruba. Aruba? Arugula. Arabalbalbla. Arvois? Arubla. Arulalala. Ariel? Oreo? Oreo. Oreo. What am I doing? Okay. Last I heard, he landed in Aruba. When the rest of him landed in Cancun.
Yes, quite tragic. Entire occult science building exploded, leaving only a crater, oddly filled with indentations of the faces of the workers and students who were in there. That was before our time, of course.
Since we're alive and whatnot.
Huh. But there's, like, protections from that happening again, right?
Oh, yeah. They put a sneeze guard in.
Exactly.
Right.
Well. That was everybody.
Let's head to the Eldritch Library. Books branded with the school's insignia are to, under no circumstances, leave the library. Branded books found outside the library will be shot on sight.
Let's talk to this cutie. She's one of my favorites. Oh my god, look at her. She's so cute. Ah! Okay. A fun trick of the black magic users of the old days was to write how-to spellbooks that simply by reading them would cast the curse that the reader was trying to learn on the reader themselves. Fiendish, but funny, according to them.
What happened to your eye holes?
How to throw ethereal fire directly into somebody's eyes. Luckily, it was just the Cliff Notes version.
Oh, I love her. She's so cute.
Help.
I want a plushie of her. Oh my god.
All my classes are at 7 a.m. Got any ideas for a book that'll help me wake me up in the morning?
You'll want internalized zombification in the necrology aisle. All the benefits of being a zombie without the drawbacks of looking like a corpse. Though your intestines will occasionally fall out of your butthole.
Huh.
They must have a book for everything. Though, I'd take coffee over scooping intestines back into my butthole. Maybe that's just me. Let's head into the library. Hey, Emily, do you guys have any books on advanced witchcraft? I want to keep fresh while I'm here. I'll take that as an, of course we do, Charlotte. Have you seen the size of this goddamn library? We got books that ain't even been written yet. I'm so glad that my idea for Ald was not just me alone. That out there in the ether of creation, there are other eldritch writers who are like, obviously, there's a reason why people would just say, oh, for everything that they ever say. Anyway, The Science of Rain Dancing by Professor Anna Undercarriage. Huh. Guess maybe I'll fit in here a little better than I thought. I've been doing science all this time. Much like electricity, the human body acts as a conductor of magical energy intrinsic in the air of regions of high concentration. This effect is exacerbated with wet skin, leading to many witch cults dancing naked in the rain in order to conjure spells effectively. Indeed, it seems paranormal encounters seem more frequent when it's raining or in regions of the world where rain is frequent. The witch cults of Seattle and Scotland are considered incredibly powerful and fearsome, though this is simply due to their geographical advantage. Would they to be taken away from their home deluges, they would be simply as effective as their new weather permits them to be. Ha! Sick burn. Hello, Wobbly, what you reading? Nothing, just some stuff about witches. You wouldn't get it. Nah, probably not. That stuff's too cool and magical for a dumb old cannibal like Annie. No place for an ugly old purple blood like poor old dumb old cannibal Annie. Poor dumb Annie. What? Well, hey, come on. I didn't mean it like that. Hey, next time it rains, I could teach you a few tricks. How about it? You get a pet frog, give it a couple extra eyes. What do you say? That sounds fun, but can I make a suggestion? Sure, I guess. Rather than rain, can we dance around in buffalo sauce? I think I want a little zing when I bite your bum. Damn it, Annie, why don't you go bug somebody else? 'Cause you're the only one that finds it funny. There's a difference between laughing at something because it's funny and laughing at something because it's ridiculous. Most folks run away from the likes of me. They seem to take threats of being devoured quite seriously. And there's nothing I'd like more than watching you run away, Charlotte. Aw, you beat me to it. Yeah, see you around, Annie. She's my favorite. Help. Somebody help. I love her. I love Annie so much. Oh, gosh. Hey, Lizzie, what you got there?
Grilly cheese. It's the best human invention. Everyone says so.
Everyone? Like, everyone in the university?
Everyone in this dimension. The Migo, the Yithians, the Starspawn, Chthonians when someone makes one for them, the homeworld elder things. Even Yogg-Sothoth likes one now and again.
Really? Not like the internal combustion engine, not penicillin, the telephone, light bulbs, eyeglasses, great big trains, microscopes?
No, we don't need any of that.
So, humanity, for all its achievements, all the love and loss, all the wars, all the technology and innovation, all the art and culture, everything that we've done, and we're considered by the rest of the universe as those guys that make a mean grilled cheese.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know how to feel about that. So, hey, why do so many people have tentacles coming out of their back? Oh god, what is that on his throat?
Have you ever faced a bapho-necrotic explosion head-on?
No, can't say that I have.
Neither has anyone else. First rule of bapho-necrotic explosions, turn away from the bapho-necrotic explosion. Well, I guess the first rule would be don't cause a goddamn bapho-necrotic explosion, but people can't seem to help breaking that one.
You can probably tell from the lack of extra limbs, but I have no idea what a bapho-whatever actually is.
It's the process of deliberately caving in an artificial portal through our dimension to stop extra-dimensional entities from getting out. It's a last resort, since usually there are teams of portal divers still inside, but hey, better than the end of the world, huh?
I guess. Hey, maybe you guys should try transmutation circles. That's what us witches use when we need to summon creepy stuff, and none of my coven have any weird weirdo tentacles. All you need is chalk, a little blood, some candles.
And a complete disregard for pants. Yes, yes, we've all been taught the witch method, but the scientific method reduces the element of randomness, increases the size and duration of portals to allow for human entry, and best of all, you get to keep your clothes on.
So science is magic plus underwear, huh? I didn't read that conversation beforehand on my previous go-through here. That was fucking great.
So what's with the puppets? We help her talk with unfamiliar people on unfamiliar subjects. One must become more familiar with us in order to become more familiar with her. Spent a little too long in the psychology department, huh? I've heard research in all of them dark psychiatrics can rub off on people. And you've spent a little too long in engineering to not know when someone's pulling your leg. So working and studying in certain buildings has a residual effect. I wonder what effect working in the occult science building has on witches. I hope I don't start taking a chalkboard to my coven's dance rituals. No one wants to know the angle or of rotation of one of my sick freeballing pirouettes. Studying at the Miskatonic is a huge opportunity. There are so few monster hunters in my hometown. I think my job prospects in the future are pretty bright.
It does come with a few drawbacks, though. You're not likely to finish your studies exactly the same species you started.
Well, hey, at the very worst, I'm pretty sure this place could always use more freaky-ass teachers. Positive attitude. So what do you reckon they're doing in there?
Poking and prodding, same as always. Eventually they'll get bored, and we'll be tasked with carting off the husk.
If you told tiny child Oliver that in the future carrying corpses would be considered the easiest part of his day, I think he'd pitch a fit. I'd have thought the part between carrying the body to the corporeum and carrying it away would be the easiest part. Though, I guess hanging out in this spooky-ass hall can be a little exhausting, too.
Just a small word of advice to the biology department. You can't just stick a dog and a war veteran into a centrifuge and rejigger them mush into a living being. And everyone say hello to the world's very first werewolf. There's clearly a reason I'm not down there with you guys. Aside from, you know, the carnage it would cause.
Did you guys hear that? A goddamn werewolf? You guys want to check it out?
We're not done here, Mike. We've got to get the incinerators going before we can knock off.
Connor's right. First we burn whatever nightmare the crematorium's working on, then we can go
gawk at whatever nightmare the biology department's working on. They got their own burners, after all.
I always thought you had to get bit by a werewolf to become a werewolf. Then again, why would any werewolf stop at one bite, not just eat whatever it was biting? Maybe that's why we don't have zombie plagues anymore. Let's head into... Oh, I didn't read the student corporeum. Students are encouraged to practice vivisection during recreational hours. Using the locally bred horrors, nightmares, pets, or children available, these resources are included in your tuition. Oh, man, look at this sick, awesome thing. That's so gross. That tough stuff is a colony of cuddleworms, complete with a bloody spinal cord of their human host. They like to lay their eggs in city water pipes, and once consumed, they attach to the spinal columns of their host, eventually controlling their every move. Sort of like zombies, except, you know, a lot more screaming and begging for death, right? Very interesting species. That's a deceptively adorable name for the worst thing ever. I bet the boy's a tenor that I could yank the spine out of this poor sod's mouth. Turns out the worms form a rock-solid grip on the host's brain while they're piloting them. Fingers here is gonna give him a prod, see if she can't get him to let go of the bugger's melon meat. Oh, here we go. Excuse me. I just had a dark thought encouraging that I slit my wrists. Take off your trousers and play your bum like the bloody bongos. Probably better to use spare blood, eh? C'est la vie. Aw, big strong man helping out little lady's sadistic madness. Cute. Does that mean that I don't want to think about it. Essentially, you just need to maintain your resources, spending them on village and stat upgrades, but village upgrades give passive benefits to both villages. So you need to be careful that you're not helping the other team and their village. See, that's where I went wrong with my first game. After I constructed our breeding pit, the other village gained enough population resources to spend their build and foraging process. What the shit are they talking about? Oh, she's so cute. So, after you've drawn from the encounter deck, if what you draw is a monster, pick from the monster deck, then you can choose to fight or flee. If you fight, compare your player card's ferocity stat with the monster's and add a d6 to both stats to determine whether you win or lose. If you want to flee, it's the same process with the liquidity stat. Oh, her hair is like a tentacle. Once you've returned to the village board, you can add your successful foraging tokens to the village's stockpile. Whatever team successfully builds their village first wins, or whatever team's village runs out of food, materials, or population resources loses. And do I have to go by my in-game name too? Couldn't hurt. They must be talking about some sort of board game. Never played one before. Not many places to put the board when you're off dancing in the woods with nothing but a smile on. And nowhere to keep the pieces.
What's unique about our planet is that all the plants and animals share a universal language or a sort of collective consciousness, guiding things like migratory patterns, blooming seasons, what is predator and what is prey, things like that. It also acts as a conduit of the emotions of organic life. Flowers plucked, the garden screams, a cow is slaughtered, the whole herd weeps. Humans seem to have lost this ability over the last 100,000 years, and those few that can hear it go mad with the knowledge of it. Just so you know, the plant is very upset with you humans.
Guess I better go apologize to my bagel. Oh man, I hope that ain't true. As a witch cultist of a love goddess, I should probably be spreading the love to everything, not just humans. And I've eaten a whole lot of burgers. Hello again, how's it going?
So you're the one that taught the Ethereum to talk, huh?
I guess, but I think he already knew. Hi, I'm...
Wait. Let me figure it out. Layer of grime over the extremities so you're aware of the mutagenic atmosphere and have applied a home remedy. So you're local to New England. But no real accompanying stench other than that of dead flowers. So you're often with other people. Mild wobbling at the touch indicates a lack of exercise, but the very dirty boots means you're outside in the rain a lot. Judging by the short black skirt and choker, you're an active worshiper of Sheb-Niggurath, the goddess of love and humanity. And combining the grime, wobbliness, smell, and outfit, you must therefore be a member of the Chesuncook Witch Coven. Wow, exactly. Although, they were just observations, so what's with the creepy tentacles? This is as close to a handshake as I get.
Oh, well, enchanté. So, what's your deal?
Oh, I'm Jessica Morgan. I'm the record keeper for experiments performed on the Necronomicon, though I was a detective before my arms got all noodled.
How do you keep records if you can't control your arms? With a handshake like that, how would you hold a pen?
What do you mean? I have perfect control of my arms.
Oh. Oh.
Well, it was nice meeting you. See you later, Ethereum.
Bye, Sophie.
I love everything about this game. Do those wormy things act as your arms? That's pretty groovy.
Yep. The thing to remember about all the occult shenanigans is that most of these monsters are just really ugly animals, and animals can be trained.
Cool. How'd you train them?
Traditional combination of treats and mild punishment. As a treat, I let them keep my arms. And as a punishment, I headbutted the shit out of them. Now, they never leave Mommy's side. Don't even have to command them for the easy stuff.
What counts as easy stuff when training floating worms to act as replacement arms?
Oh, you know, cooking, cleaning, getting changed, all the essentials. You should see me play the trombone.
So, what's with folks changing their names for that board game people are talking about? It's to make the consequences of the game seem more real. A lot of people need an escape from work or their studies, and the game's a good way to do that.
Huh.
You think I could play with you guys? When I've got some time off or whatever? Depends. What's your in-game game gonna be?
Thrust powerful, badass barbarian, saving...
I have a delivery.
Badass barbarian saving sick wenches or whatever.
Nope. Bye. Better than everyone else's dumbass names. Whatever, who'd want to play a game where thrust powerful the badass barbarian sounds non-canon anyway? The geography building has probably the least dangerous lessons on campus, but also has the highest security. Can't have the public figure out where the plateau of Lang is, or worse, bleh. Why not? You know how some people can't help but get close as they can to the scene of a car crash? Imagine that car crash being a centralized supernatural apocalypse based in the Pacific Ocean. Folks would climb over each other to check that out.
Yeah, I guess. I bet it looks pretty radical.
There are several benefits to having every internal organ replaced by half-sentient liquid slurry. For example, you wouldn't believe how much of your brain is dedicated to simply maintaining the automatic process of your body. With the slime, my brain is now free to fully ponder the questions of the universe.
Well, I gotta admit, you're putting on a good experience. Still, having to carry a handkerchief around to mop the incorrigible sludge out of my eye sockets, this is a drawback.
Forget hygiene. You're at the Miskatonic. If you're only trailing black slime, you're practically cleaning the place up. Nothing gets an occult scientist down, I guess. Though, wouldn't his brain also be replaced by the goo? That's gross. That's really gross. And we're in Bob's office. Staff are encouraged to only disturb Bob on matters of immediate security or apocalyptic concern. Students are encouraged to go away.
Good afternoon, Charlotte. Are you ready for your first assignment?
Sure, lay it on me.
Excellent. The Miskatonic has small research outposts located all over the world dedicated to collecting and relaying occult data back to the university via radio. One such outpost is in New Orleans, where you'll be going.
Okay. What happened in New Orleans?
We're not sure. Our research is supposed to relay daily radio messages back to us, but hasn't checked in for several days. Your task is to go to the outpost and knock on the door. If he's there, ask why he hasn't been relaying data. If he's not, return and tell us.
That's it? Knock on the door?
Exactly. Under no circumstances are you to enter the outpost. Just knock and leave.
Okay. So, how do I get there? After a few, well, disasters, the government demanded that the Miskatonic's experiments be completely sealed off from the outside world. As a result, every outpost in the country is interconnected by these tunnels. Help stop transporting creatures running off into the wilderness, see? Spooky. So, I'm walking to New Orleans. Oh, no, of course not. You'll have a driver.
Hi.
Ah, Lizzie. Hey. Looks like driving down in the spooky-ass tunnel system together.
Yes. New Orleans is not too far in straight lines. Should get there lickety-split.
Have fun, you two. And remember, don't go into the outposts. Okay. See you later, Johnny. Guess this is the place. Huh, that's weird. The door's open.
So?
Well, the mission is to knock on the door, see if anyone's in, and then leave. If the door's open, something bad might have happened.
Like what?
I don't know. It could be anything. Maybe they're out of banana bread. Maybe someone's pregnant and they've gone to get a doctor. Maybe Cthulhu cultists have invaded to have a sick hoedown. Maybe they're pregnant with a Cthulhu cultist banana bread baby. We should check it out.
Supposed to be authorized to go into outposts. Dunwitchers and witches are for knocking on doors, not poking around outposts.
Come on. We'll be, you know, showing initiative. They'll be like, wow, Lizzie and Charlotte, you sure saved the day poking around in that outpost. Good thing you did, or all those chupacabras would go back to home base and eat all of us.
I don't think that's what they'll say.
Well, I'm gonna take a look. Feel free to join me if you want to save the university from chupacabras.
Guess it'll be okay if we just look.
Fear the goo. New Orleans outpost. Initially, the outposts were each equipped with long-range radio systems, able to communicate with each other, stave off the loneliness, good for morale, until the Australia outpost incident broadcasted the screaming of an entire country on all frequencies. Now the outposts can only communicate with the Miskatonic hub, can't hear each other, good for morale. I wonder if that was, during the Shoggoth invasion. Miskatonic Outpost, New Orleans, 48B? Maybe? Collection facility. Fear the goo. What do you gotta say, Lizzie? I better sweep this whole room before we move on. That's a detective thing to do. Who decided you were a detective? You're a security guard. What happens if we try to leave? Nothing. It doesn't even give me a cutscene. Okay. Huh. Fear the goo. Written in goo. What goo should I be fearing? Should I fear the goo the fear the goo sign is written in?
Maybe is peanut butter. Humans are allergic, right?
Only the ones who hate deliciousness. Nope. I think this is a warning about the same goo it's written in. Can't be that dangerous then if the Warner preferred using it over, you know, a pen.
Maybe he has no pen. Maybe his pen is goo. Maybe that's why he's so afraidy. Because of pen goo.
Guess there's only one way to find out. Let's keep going. The goo room. There's a lot of it. What do you gotta say, Lizzie? Fuck. Why can't I talk to Lizzie? That's a lot of goo. Extraction facility. Initially, we thought the signs were overkill, the Miskatonic already being notorious for its anal-retentive approach to the supernatural. Alas, after several decades and several thousand casualties, we learned that the most dangerous thing in our work was a wandering mind. Extraction facility. Tools broken during extraction process shall be replaced from the technician's wages. Extraction tools are for ooze extraction only. As scrumptious as the inside of jelly donuts are, extraction tools are not a suitable method of obtaining said jelly. Wow. Just gonna... Who... Jelly donuts? No, you need the custard-filled ones. Those are so... Oh my gosh, I want some custard-filled donuts now. I haven't had donuts in, like, 6 months. Ah! And now that we're all quarantined... Ugh... I don't know when I'm ever gonna have a donut again. Shitballs. The door is locked.
So?
So there might be goodies inside. Eldritch goodies. Look, it says there. Extraction facility. This must be where they're getting the goo. We gotta get in there.
Why?
Because if someone tells me to fear something, I like to know exactly where that something comes from and how to punch whoever made it in the head. Whoop some ass. Besides, it sounds exactly like something the hottest neo-occult detective team in New Orleans would do, right? Solving some sick mysteries?
Okay.
Little Yachaninte. They were allowed a small number of personal effects on site. Easier to just let them have their little trinkets than to enforce contraband rules, and the occasional knife in the gut for a supervisor was seen as an affordable expense. Huh. Innsmouth. Looks like a poster of Innsmouth. Home of the Deep Ones. Maybe that's where whoever lived here was from.
Well, that's a deep one.
They were this race of fishy, froggy folk that lived in this underwater city off the coast of Innsmouth. In exchange for plentiful fishing and crabbing seasons, they would mate with the local Innsmouth babies and create little baby hybrids. Apparently, it was a pretty sweet deal until some wandering douche came through the town and ruined it all. Went and told the government they torpedoed the underwater city and rounded everyone up and sent them to concentration camps and whatnot. Kind of sad, really. I hear the little hybrid tadpoles are adorable. Looks like a syringe. And that's a beefy-ass needle hole thing, too. This goo is either going into something or coming out of something. Either way, it looks like it'd hurt like hell. Some sort of manifesto. April 9th, half gallon. His name was Daniel. April 10th, 2 gallon. Told me to give her locket to her lover. April 11th, 1 gallon. He was still alive. What have I done? And then it stops. Huh.
Hmm.
Huh. Looks like a diary. Each night, my darling wife, hidden deep in the back room of an Orlesian brothel, prays to her goddess Shub-Niggurath, keeping the faith groovy, that we might find a new home, and that I might work much less dreadful. She is becoming too large to convincingly lie that she is carrying a human child, so we must gather our pennies and leave soon. Huh, there's a little photo. Aw, look at her, so pretty, so full of tadpoles. And he is kind of handsome in that, you know, amphibious way. Aw.
Why is that aw? Why is that not ew?
All the storybooks say that there's no purer love than that between a girl and a frog.
What?
April 12th, 1936. Hey, that's yesterday. A new prisoner was delivered for ooze extraction. He claims he was a riverboat captain with a ship that sails up and down the Mississippi River. He claims that there is a deep one refuge situated in Minnesota, wherein my people live and thrive, hidden from the university's horrific testing and the government's terrible claims. I shall rescue my beloved tonight, under cover of darkness, and we three shall make for Minnesota. I'll miss the radio call-in, and they shall send someone to investigate my squalid concrete prison, but we shall be long gone. Huh. Looks like the university was keeping this feller against his will, using him to extract goo from folks. But why?
Maybe we should ask him.
No way. If the university is as evil as this guy says they are, we best keep our mouths shut and do a little independent investigating. We gotta find out what that goo is, what they're using it for, and why they're being such bastards. Holding cell. Every outpost, no matter how small, no matter what research is housed, had to have a holding cell. The topics we study at the Miskatonic have an alarming rate of contagion. Holding cell, not for holding delicious pastries. I hope that we meet this fish guy and he's like a bakery owner or something, I don't know. Fucking shit on my dick, another goddamn locked door.
You look angrier than you should be.
Sorry, the concept of, you know, privacy makes witches a little testy. Whatever, let's find ourselves some keys and F these locks up. And we're back to a different part of a little Yachinti. The deep ones could be manipulated in a way humans couldn't. They had what the brains called a deeper emotional intelligence than us. They would cry at the simple concept of tragedy, so to threaten them with their own was viciously effective. And the problem with that is that emotional intelligence didn't exist until the 90s. The concept wasn't like, I mean, you know, compassion and things that emotional intelligence are about, being able to have empathy and everything existed throughout humanity, but the actual idea of the two words, emotional intelligence, I don't even know if IQ was established by 1936. I could be wrong. I know that it happened early on in the 1900s. Dead Randy, sexy necromancer. What the fuck? Are those super rare Dead Randy monogamy art covers? How did he get these? These are ultra banned all across America. We gotta take these.
What?
Dead Randy, the sexy necromancer. It's this cute little incubus that runs around saving zombie girls after the world ends. And then bones them. This story arc was written by my first coven den mother, Agnes G. Williker. It's a story of how this succubus girl, this purple girl here, wants Dead Randy all to herself. But while they're all mutual, Dead Randy gets sad that he's not boning mad dames, and him and the succubus girl learn that love should be shared with everyone, not saved for individuals. It's adorable.
Why'd humans ban it?
The same reason they ban everything. Folks were getting too cheerful. People having fun. Just gotta ban that. Pull out that Nerf hammer. Fun? Promoting cultist ideologies, they said. Not sure how love everyone you can and don't be a douche is considered the same as, you know, let's get Cthulhu to F up the world. But whatever. Plus, I guess Dead Randy is pretty rampant in this series. Hard to get that love everyone message across in a story about a nymphomaniac... A nymphomaniacal blue midget without getting, you know, vigorous. But the message was so awesome! Completely true to our cult's mantra, and everyone in Chess and Cook thought us witches were pretty groovy after these stories came out. I don't think people were saying groovy in the 1930s. But that's okay, I'll stop nitpicking. Just like I don't think French people say we all the time. My mentor in my lab is French, and he never says we. People say it to him ironically, and he just smiles. Preach love and compassion for the universe offers neither. They put that as our town motto after Miss Agnes wrote this series. Come on, he's gotta have the hard copy somewhere. The girls in the coven will shit their minds when they hear what I've found.
Dead Randy, the Sexy Necromancer, Harmony Arc, Episode 1, Death of a Deviant. Once again, Dead Randy finds himself expelled from the Incubus Academy of Hell for failing the not-looking-like-a-tawny-idiot portion of the class. Forever exiled, Randy seeks refuge on a desolate earth, destroyed by a mysterious plague that leaves the land barren in all but zombies. Using his powers of necromancy, Dead Randy cobbles together another village made of bone and sinew, drawing zombies from all over the wasteland looking for a place to live. Once populated, Randy affectionately names his new town the Bone Zone.
Aw, yeah. I peek a few cutes. Why am I doing that? I can edit my voice and post to sound like I'm on a radio show. Ah. Well, next episode I will keep that in mind. Oh yeah, I peek a few cute zombie girls in that shambling horde. One-way ticket to the Bone Zone.
Dead Randy, the Sexy Necromancer, Harmony Arc, Episode 2, Damsel in Decay. With the Bone Zone completed and the zombie villagers settled, Dead Randy enjoys a life of carnal luxury. But with the hordes of zombies come their arch nemesis, the only living creatures left on Earth. That's right, packs of feral Pomeranians are attacking villagers of the Bone Zone. And when one of his lovely consorts are dragged away, it's up to Dead Randy to save her and drive away the feral pups.
Man, he is humping the shit out of that zombie. I'm starting to understand why they banned this arc. Butts aren't supposed to fall off. Oh god, he's terrifying.
Dead Randy, the Sexy Necromancer, Harmony Arc, Episode 3, Polyamorous Pollyanna. A new visitor from the underworld arrives at the Bone Zone, a salacious succubus named Sally. Marveled by his accomplishments, Sally becomes enamored with Dead Randy, demanding that the pair revoke their demonic job descriptions and become mutual lovers. Shocked at the idea that another demon could love him, and much to the dismay of the hordes of the zombie girls, Randy vows to become Sally's boyfriend.
Poor Dead Randy, seduced by the idea of exclusive affection. Like my dead mother always says, love 100 people and 1,000 people will love you back. Oh, that's a really nice sentiment.
Dead Randy, the Sexy Necromancer, Harmony Arc, Episode 4, Trouble in Paradise. After a few months of unrelenting ravaging, Randy and Sally start to become bored of their exclusivity. But while Randy aches to share his love with the rest of the village, Sally demands that he spend his pent-up affection on grinding through their turbulent relationship.
Bad move, Sally. You've got two folks going against the nature of sharing happiness with the world, desperately trying to keep their happiness between each other. Share it. And the last one. Monogamy madness.
Dead Randy, the sexy necromancer, Harmony Arc, episode 5, Monogamy Madness. Finally, Sally and Randy see the error of their ways. After an amicable breakup and a promise to remain sharing a portion, albeit a small one, of their love between each other, Randy and Sally tear through the bone zone, vigorously loving everyone in their path.
Oh, I love a happy ending. I guess the last 40 pages are just meant to, you know, lock the message down. Not quite sure what the zombie butts falling off is supposed to represent, but I'm sure Miss Agnes nailed the metaphor, whatever it is. Okay, now it's just pervy. Well, that was fun. I learned about sharing affection with the people I meet, being kind and caring, and learning not to judge others, and, well, how to bone mad zombie dames. Let's carry on with the investigation. Designated sleeping area. That looks like a couch, I slept on a couch for like 10 years of my life because I just didn't want to get a bed. Look, before we go any further, let me just say that what we do at the Miskatonic is sometimes a little vicious or a little sadistic, even abjectly cruel, but it's necessary, all right? The universe is a writhing cauldron of unrelenting malice. We do what we must to make sure you don't realize that fact. A key to the holding cell. Let's head back to that locked door and check it out. Success. Now, let's find out where this goo's coming from. Oh.
What's that?
It's a brain. A human one. With holes in.
Don't humans need their brains?
Yeah. Yeah, they do. There's gotta be an explanation for this. The university stealing brains to extract weird orange brain goo out of them? I mean, why? What's the point?
This is probably why they didn't want us in here. 'Cause of brain goo experiments.
Yeah, we're gonna have to play it cool. Figure out who we can trust at the university and ask some questions. Well, Rumman's been there a while, and I know I can trust a fellow witch.
And you can trust a fellow Lizzie.
Exactly. That's like half the faculty right there. Besides, I'm sure there's a reasonable explanation for all this. We just gotta be careful not to get fired for insubordination or treason or whatever. Come on, partner. Let's go do us some sleuthing back at home base.
So, Charlotte, how was your assignment?
Good. It was good. Knocked on the door, waited around outside for a while, no response, came back home.
And you didn't go inside the outpost?
Inside? Oh, no, no. I didn't go inside. I was told not to, so I didn't. I just knocked on the door and left. Haha, inside you, crazy. Did you polish your teeth? Did you use a little floss today? And just, you know,
Right. Well, we'll send a team to investigate and search for our missing researcher. Thank you, Charlotte. We had no intention of sending you on an assignment so early.
So, what do I do now?
You return to your quarters and get some rest. Tomorrow, you will start patrolling the occult science building.
Right. Well, talk to you later, Bob. Looks like we're in the clear, Liz.
Are we still being detectives?
Damn right. We're gonna get to the bottom of this. But for now, let's get some sleep and start investigating tomorrow.
Okay, see you tomorrow, Charlotte. I'm gonna go pray to Yogg-Sothoth.
See you, Lizzie. So, I'm gonna wrap up this episode right here. I'll probably make the following ones shorter. I'm recording this in post because I've spent way longer editing this than I expected to, but man, it's been a fucking blast. I love this game so much. Yeah. Thanks, and as always, sweet dreams.